Okay, these are my two spacecraft. They're orbiting the moon right now. These two spacecraft, they're about the size of a dishwasher, okay, or I like to say an apartment-sized washer and dryer. And they were this spring mapping the moon at an altitude of 55 kilometers and flying in precise formation. And we're measuring the distance between the two, how the distance is changing down to about a tenth of a micron per second, so that we can measure the moon's gravity field with great precision. This fall, we've taken the spacecraft altitude down so that the altitudes above the lunar surface are approaching the height that commercial airplanes fly above the surface of the Earth. And it's very challenging to keep these two spacecraft in orbit. But we're learning a lot about the interior of the moon. We're studying the early evolution of planets and what this tells us actually about the period of time that life developed on Earth, and actually we hope to improve parameters in fundamental physics. But that's not what I'm here to talk about today. For a long time, I said to myself that if I ever got the opportunity to lead a mission, that I was going to take as many young people as I could along with me for the ride. Okay, and I'm going to talk about the education aspect of this mission. It's called MoonCam, and this is a camera experiment that we have on the spacecraft, which is the first imaging experiment on a NASA mission that has no scientific requirement. It is completely dedicated to education and outreach. And this is actually work that I did in collaboration with Sally Ride, America's first woman in space. Sally has dedicated her career since retiring from the astronaut program to educational matters. And this is the last major project that she worked on until she passed away in July. And Sally and I decided that ownership was going to be very important. Other NASA imaging experiments have taken some pictures that have allowed students to take some pictures, a handful there, but very few because of the fact that this instrumentation was due to science. We wanted cameras that were going to be owned by students. So the problem with that, it's an opportunity, of course, but the challenge is that spacecraft instrumentation is very expensive. And so we had to find a way to do this in an inexpensive way so that it would be affordable. And so so that camera up there, those are rocket cams. They are the cameras that we strap onto the sides of rockets so that when a rocket takes on and the stages separate, you see the video of the stages separating. And what we were able to do is put one electronics box and four cameras on each one of the spacecraft that were all oriented in different directions so that we wouldn't have moving parts, which allowed us to simplify the operations as well as minimize mechanisms, which is also another challenge in spaceflight. Okay, I could have the next slide, please. Okay, and so the idea here is that ownership is empowering. So since we've done this experiment, I've had a number of adults send me emails saying, well, we'd like to take a picture of the moon, you know, could you take this for us? And I say, they're not my cameras. You need to get in touch with a student who's in the program. We've targeted this at middle school students because middle school is the period of time when students have to decide whether or not they're going to take the hard math that puts them on the AP track in high school that allows them to major in science and engineering in college. And we decided that a student, if engaged and excited about an idea, would do vast amounts of work to figure out how to target images on the lunar surface. We have a program that gets downloaded to their high school where they have to figure out where the spacecraft are going to be flying over at a given time. They target their images, and they get uploaded to the spacecraft. And actually, this is a picture here of a classroom, but it's not an exactly correct picture, I would say, because it shows the teacher helping the student. Overwhelmingly, the case is that the students teach the teachers how to use the software that we've given them. So, and in this program last spring, we have 100,000 images of the moon that have been taken by students in 3,000 participating classrooms across the country. So the reach of this experiment has been considerable. Okay, so I'm going to show a little bit. So we have four cameras on each spacecraft, two of which point down, one of which points forward, one of which points backward. They have different resolutions, and I'm just going to show you a couple of examples of things that middle school students, primarily middle school, are learning about the moon. Okay. So the first is students have been looking at what the effect of viewing geometry is of features on the surface. So this is what you see there is a picture of a feature called Rainier Gamma, which is a magnetic structure. And students have targeted that at different viewing angles. It's actually a swirl on the lunar surface that has very high magnetics associated with it. And the students are trying to understand whether or not there's something in the geology which is telling us the nature of why there is a very high magnetization. Students are studying illumination conditions. So here's two different pictures of the same crater taken under different lighting angles, where the students are trying to understand how the position, where the position of the sun is, the moon, and the spacecraft, and how this allows one to highlight different features in the of the features on the surface. The students are going in and studying regional geology. So this is the feature on the left is Sinus Iridum, which is a part of the moon, Oceanus Procellarum, which is about 10 o'clock on the clock if you view the full moon as a clock. And feature C, that's the rim of a large impact basin, and A, that whole area has been flooded by lava, and the students are doing geologic reconstructions of these areas. On the right-hand side is a valley that's associated with faulting on the surface. Here's pictures that the students have taken of the Apollo landing site, Taurus Littrow, and you might be able to see there that the students have actually gone through and reconstructed the traverses that the Apollo astronauts made on the surface of the moon. And the last things I'll show, this has led to things beyond the lesson plan in terms of engineering. So this is we did a student expo. I rented the Reagan Rotunda in Washington, D.C. and invited elected officials and heads of societies to come in and view the work that the students are doing. And this young seventh grade young man here got interested in the gravity part of the experiment, went onto the NASA Planetary Data System, downloaded an old lunar gravity model, and wrote a MATLAB program to do a spherical harmonic expansion and plot the gravity field. And he asked me when I was going to get him a better gravity field. So, and then finally, we have a tool that allows students who take images from different areas to put them in Google Moon, which is actually a module of Google Earth, and find out what students in different classrooms have been studying. And so students who are studying an image in a particular area can get into communication with students who are working in different areas and compare notes in trying to do their geological studies. So So in summary here, we talk a lot about educational standards. And if you look at what the educational standards say that students should learn about the moon in middle school, it doesn't go much beyond the moon goes through phases, and this tells us that the moon revolves around the Earth. Okay, but I think with this presentation, I hope I've told you that there is so much more that is possible, and that with a judicious investment and some creativity, that we can actually use space exploration as a real tool for educational advancement.